GLK I just bought is up in the air in the garage, waiting for its repair. I bought it for much less than it should have cost, because it had a little problem with the driveshaft. It's not an uncommon problem. It broke off, did some damage underneath, O2 sensors and such. But the big job that I'm in the process of doing now is going to be rebuilding the transfer case. Because while I was down there, I noticed play in the output shaft of the transfer case, which is invariably inside this unit, which is not rebuildable. And so I had to source one of these. That was the difficult part. That came from Poland. But by all accounts, a very reputable vendor, good quality. I'm very happy with what I see here. New drive shaft, of course. I'm going to go ahead and rebuild the transfer case by replacing all the bearings as well, because they are also a weak point, and I don't want to have problems with this car down the road. So I've got the seals and 4 bearings to replace. Some of the other things I'm going to need, you need some Permatex, the automatic transmission gasket maker, because the transfer case comes off in 2 pieces and neither one of them have gaskets, so it's sealed with this. You will absolutely positively need to find this bolt. I'll add some information about that in the text of the video so that you can find it. Because this sets the preload on the main output shaft, helical gear, bearings. You do not want to put the old one back in. I'll need a new nut for the tail shaft, the rear drive shaft that is, because it's got to come out. So I could probably reuse the old one, but I'm going to replace it. Of course, four new bolts for the new drive shaft. The old ones are toast. And something I didn't have yet, which was this goes into the fill port, actually the drain plug on the transmission, so that you can pump new fluid, something else you need, into the transmission when you're done. I don't know exactly how much will drain out. I'm going to drain it from the transfer case, so it should be an interesting process. I've got some special tools that I've been accumulating that I'll need to get this job done. So let's get started. Okay, the transfer shaft itself is actually what the dealer will tell you is an integral part of the transmission, and it is in fact bolted on. It doesn't look like a typical add-on transfer case, but it does come off in 2 pieces. This is the rear suction housing, and then the front suction housing here. And the first big step is going to be dropping the drive shaft, because that's got to come off in order to get anything off. And as you can see, it's pretty well obscured by lots of other stuff. It appears that the exhaust system doesn't have to come down, which is good news. But I will have to take off these large plastic panels, get them out of the way, and then relocate. That will allow me to relocate this heat shield here that covers the front half of the drive shaft. I'll have to drop the drive shaft out. I'm not sure how far I'll have to move it to get the clearance I need. We'll learn that together as we go.
Okay, there's one 8mm bolt that goes in there. The rest of them are the captive 10mm plastics, and there's a couple of these little pegs you've got to release. So you'll need to get a tool to do that. Okay, next are the 4 8mm nuts on the next heat shield. I suspect we have to get more than that to get to access to the center support bearing, which will be necessary for moving the drive shaft out of the way. Okay, now that should be loose, but And just to be thorough, of course, they hid an 8mm up in between the mufflers. I don't know. Okay. It's not really hard to get to with a 8mm socket with a wobble. Give you just that little bit of extra angle you need to get it out. Go ahead and take off the next cover, which may or may not be enough, but
may not be absolutely necessary, but I'm going to drop this support. Just 4 bolts. It will keep me from having to deform these heat shields a whole lot, make it easier to get them on and off without messing them up. So easily worth it. Okay, the driver's left side middle cover comes out just fine. The right side is a little finicky, but it's easy to slide back way out of the way. It doesn't really matter if you take it out or not. You just need to get it out of the way so you can get access to the center support bearing. Now, you do not want to remove the center support bearing until you get the other ends loose. So I'm not going to do that. The other thing you want to do before you get too far down the road is you want to mark the alignment of the drive shaft, on, which you can now do. I'm going to mark it on. So this yoke and the flex disc and this yoke, so that they are, put back in the same alignment. That is important. You want to do that front and back. So I will do that now before I forget it and end up causing problems. Okay, the front is marked and the back is marked. It should go without saying that if while you're doing this job you notice any deterioration on your flex discs, this would be an awesome time to replace them. Okay, T60 torque socket, 18mm wrench, and you're off to the races. And I love Western cars because the hardware comes off so much easier. And now to I notice I'm taking off the bolts attached to the yoke on the transmission, which is important because the there's no use taking off the ones to the drive shaft because then you have to take off the other ones. Now notice I am going to have to rotate the drive shaft, which is going to require me to put the car in neutral, so I'll go do that now. Okay, if you have trouble rotating it, you can always just try the wheels, but I'll rotate the next one around here and do the same process. Didn't seem to be gorilla tight. I'm gonna have to go put it back in park to break it loose unless I can do it this way. Okay, this is even easier. Okay, that's good. Okay, it's going to be the same process for the rear. Have to rotate it to get access with the wrench and the... Alright. In this case, I can use the I can leverage the wrench against the tailpipe, which is a handy feature.
Okay, now we've got to get the yoke free of the flex disc here. And that's just going to require a little bit of leverage. You can see that there's a little bit of a metal disc inside each of the yoke lobes. So then, just a matter of rotating it around and get a pry bar into the base of the yoke and push against it. It all came out. All right, so now we're free. It's the same process in the back. But now to get the play we need to get this well and truly out of the way, it's going to require getting the center support section loose. So the center support bearing, rather. So that's next. Which one is the E12 reverse Torx socket. And pop the two bolts out. And the drive shaft is now good and well and truly, truly loose. It's just floating around in there. Good time to check for play in the CV and the CV joint and the U joints here in the middle, as well as any play in the center support bearing. This car has 150,000 miles on it, and they're both very, very tight. So I'm pleased. Okay, because of clearance back here, I can either drop the entire back end of the exhaust, and I don't want to abuse my hangers that much. So I think it's going to be easier just to go ahead and remove the flex disc altogether. Notice there are two different, I don't know if they're different size bolts, but the they're about the same. But the bolts that hold the differential yoke to the flex disc are the ones I took off initially, and they have washers on them. Just to be clear, I did mark diff on all those, and I did put a marking on the flex disc pointing to the rear, so I'll know which way that goes back on. Okay, and just once again, just pry it loose. Now the diameter of the shaft is much smaller and should fit through this gap, which should allow me to clear it in the front. But I'm going to take my time, wiggle it from the center so I don't bend up any of my heat shields that are still in place. All right, as expected, it was relatively easy then to move the drive shaft to the rear. And that has allowed me to make plenty of clearance here, as you can see, minus any shadows. I've pushed the heat shield. The heat shield is still captured above the muffler. I don't care. It's out of the way. The drive shaft is way back there. So now I got good access to get the rear yoke off and then start taking these off once I get the transmission angled down a little bit. Okay, my next step is going to be to remove this support panel. First, I'm going to take these 13 millimeter nuts off so that the support panel itself can be removed from the transmission mount. And that'll give me better clearance to get to the bolts holding the transmission or the transfer case portions on. Okay, next I'm going to loosen, just barely loosen, the eight bolts holding this entire assembly on. I'm not going to disconnect it. I'm not going to lower it yet. I'm going to get a floor jack under it. I don't think it's going to rotate the tail of the transmission down enough to matter, but I don't want an uncontrolled movement, so I am going to be careful. floor jack is now in place, just slightly holding the transmission in place. I purposely used a board with a little bit of bow in it just to see if it's putting any real weight on here. As I remove the 8 bolts that hold this cross member in, and again, I don't want to stress anything. This is just to be safe. I'm fairly certain that whenever I'm done, I'll be able to remove this cross panel altogether, get the jack out of the way, and the tail will be drooping down where I have better access without stressing anything up front. Obviously some weight coming down. Doesn't look like anything's being stressed out too bad. So I'll move on to the other side. And probably better to end with one of the middle. Should be under a little more stress because of the load. As suspected, there she sits. I may just leave that in place, but at least I'll be able to move it up and down. So I now have access to almost everything I need, and my next step is going to be to remove the I believe also the E12 4 bolts holding the tranny mount in. Again, good time to check the transmission mount. Looks solid. And that will just give me that much more clearance. Okay, next, I've got to take the dimple, I believe there are two of them, out of that nut to get the yoke off. It's going to be a little bit awkward. It's up there in a kind of strange position, so I brought several tools along. I've got a pointy chisel, flat chisel. I've got a couple sacrificial screwdrivers I've used for horrible things like that. Basically, my plan is to just drive something in there, wedge it, bend that out. It doesn't have to be perfect. I just want to get it out as far as I can so that it doesn't make the nut that much harder to get off. And many of you will have the oddball 12.30 millimeter driver you need by virtue of having bought one of these axle nut assortments. Very similar. You are going to need a deep socket to get the job done. So make sure you have that before you start it, or you're going to get about halfway through and kick yourself while your car is on jack stands in your garage waiting for the tool. All right, it was awkward, but I managed to take most of the dimples out. Basically, I don't think they really have to all come out. I'm going to cheat, and I do have enough room to put my impact up there, which should make short work of it. That's that. You may really want to have an impact whenever you're doing this, because that was not going to be any fun otherwise. And mercy of mercies, the yoke popped right off. So I am basically, at this point, I am ready to start disassembling the transmission, although the next logical step before I do that is going to be to remove the drain plug. They helpfully put a drain plug on the back of the transmission. Now, nobody ever uses it on the back of the transfer case. That's good. It's much higher than the bottom of the pan, if you can see that. So it should
end up draining less fluid out, which is fine. All I need to do is drain the transfer case. So I'm going to start that draining process tonight, let it drain overnight, and come back into a dry as possible job in the morning. 18 millimeter wrench. And the sharp-eyed among you will notice how clean the transmission fluid flowing out of this is. And that's because it, according to service records, had a fluid change only 10,000 miles ago. Another reason I don't want to do a total drain and refill, unless I find any kind of problem in the inside the case, which I don't really expect to. So now, just let it drain and come back bright-eyed and bushy-tailed tomorrow morning and start tearing into this case. Okay, much later, the next morning, we're done draining, and as you can see, really not a whole lot of fluid. I'm guessing, that's got to be well under a quart, so definitely better than doing a full drain, unless, of course, you need to change your fluid, in which case, the more, the better. So I'm going to put the drain plug back in so I don't lose track of it. Won't be needing it again until, never, hopefully. And since we're now in the assembly part, well, one small assembly part, keep in mind you really want to check for torque specs for the fasteners. In this case, the drain screw, which is 30 newton meters, which my torque wrench doesn't do. It is calibrated in inch or foot pounds rather. So set the torque wrench to 22 foot pounds, and we'll tighten the drain plug. And that's not terribly tight, so don't overdo it. Okay, a little trial and error, and I figure out that the best way to do this is a probably a 6-inch extension with my little adapter, and I'm going to use my mini torque because it's plenty to take these little bolts out. They're only torqued to about 15 or so foot-pounds, so this should pop them right out. So, and yes, it does. You have to place the bit by feel. Because it's invisible unless you crane around and get up there, but should take the bolts out easily. Might actually be a good idea to loosen the last all the bottom ones just a little bit before removing them, just so you don't end up with a lot of tension on the last bolt. They're all out. The drain pan is in place. Now, basically, it's a matter of just knocking that loose, and I'm going to use a dead blow to do that because it's been sealed, so it's like very low-grade glue, and it's going to want to stay on there unless I use a little violence. Okay, I'm going to use a pry bar to force off the rear part of the housing. It's held on with sealant pretty well, so shouldn't take a crazy amount of force to get it off, but it's on there pretty good. Okay. And I'm going to invoke the age-old truism that if at first you don't succeed, get a bigger hammer. So, in this case, 3-pound mallet. Pry bar, and there's a handy lip here.
That's the exhaust you hear ringing, not the transmission. Okay, you can see it's starting to drip. So it is coming. Ugh. And each tap is causing a spray of fluid, so I'm gonna stop and see if I can. Yeah, it's definitely coming off. So I'm gonna let it drain a little bit. That's that leftover fluid I had warned you all about. Okay, still dripping. Gonna reach over here, give it a little bit of a tweak, get some more fluid out, break some more of the seal. Just keep working it off. It's definitely coming. Okay, now it's loose and should pry right off. Oh, there, it definitely popped. Okay, a little shot of lube around the periphery of the splines. I'll let it soak for a while, see if that does any good. Okay, now it's soaked a little while, I'm going to just work it back and forth. Seems to be the trick. It's more just a tight mechanical fit than anything, I think. Alright, so now we're making progress. I'll clean it up a little bit, set it aside, and start next step, which is to get this off so we can get the back part of the case on. The trick here is that this big C-clip has to come out, and then this front plate of this comes off, giving you access to the bolt that holds the rest of it on. Take out the C-clip. Pretty thin C-clip. It's not going to take much. I'm just using an old beat-up screwdriver for the process. Okay, it's that simple. And after that, this faceplate should wiggle out. There it goes. Okay, put it someplace clean, like I just did. And now you have access to this bolt. Check these bearings while we're at it. They look fine. Okay, so need to take this bolt out, and this whole assembly will then be free to be removed. Okay, the bolt is an E10, and it should come out pretty easy, not under a whole lot of stress. And this is the non-reusable bolt. I would not recommend you reuse it at all. Alright, so now, okay, once again, the trick is above and below, just wiggle it out. It's a tight mechanical fit. But it is coming. We are getting someplace. Okay, and it all slides apart easily enough, and you can check the condition and feel for any play or unusual movement in all these intricate beveled helical gears in here. Amazing piece of kit here that Mercedes has put together. Just look for any signs of wear, and this one looks brand new, even though it does have 152,000 miles on it. Amazing. Okay, next is going to be getting the back part of the front, depending how you look at it, part of the case off. T45 fasteners all around, bolts, two up top, a bunch around the outside. You're going to want to use a wobble on your on whatever it is you're using, because some of them are just going to be more difficult to get to. This one over here might be difficult even with a wobble. I'm sure it's workable. Yeah, that's gonna be all right. But first ones, again, always go for the blind, hard to reach bolts up on top, so you can you don't have to fight them after they get tighter because you've taken all the easy ones out. All right, got the old school wrench in there, and it's coming right out. All right, I'm finding it necessary to use a half-inch drive universal joint here because of the position of these two bolts. I think the rest of them are easy enough to get to. This one up here and this one are just kind of inaccessible, but this gives me enough latitude, and they're only torqued to about, I believe, 20 foot-pounds, so they shouldn't take a gorilla amount of torque to get out. So now I'll use this to remove this one, and then the rest will be easy. Okay, this is the best setup for this, a short extension, the universal, and it gives you can brace against the body, and out she comes. Okay. All right, and this time I'm going to go around and just loosen. I have all the hard ones out, and I'm just going to loosen the remaining ones just a tiny bit so that I don't end up with the last one exceptionally tight, as happened on the rear case. So, all right. Okay, they're all broken loose. Now it's just a matter of spinning them out. And just FYI, it's going to be kind of obvious, but these two are are longer bolts. So, you'll want to make sure to make a note of that. Now I'm going to put the drip pan back under this part of the mount and remove this part of the housing. Okay, here it goes. I'm going to try to pop the case. It's going to be sticky. It's been on there a long time, a lot of miles. And I may have to use a little more violence to get it done. Okay. I'm going to give a little bit of a love tap. That's all it took. Okay. That's why they put that little lip on it. Okay, now just going to let it drip a little bit. And then work off the case, which should be like the other one. May take a little prying to get it well and truly started all the way around. That the old RTV is holding on for dear life. So okay, do not scar up the two surfaces. I'm going to put very, very gentle persuasion on this, and then work it from the top. Okay, and then down here. Okay, and it's free. Okay, what I'm fighting right now is the drive shaft is hung up on that helical gear assembly that you've seen sitting on my bench. Now, normally removing a drive shaft is difficult. In this case, not so much because the front half of the drive shaft is missing because I cut it off. So next I'm just going to I'm going to pry the remainder of the drive shaft out of place, to make removal of the back half of the case that much easier. All right, now with the drive shaft out of the way, I think the whole thing should come out easier. Okay, it just needed a lot of wiggling. It was hung on this pin. It just didn't want to come out very easily. But it is now. It's out, and now we can make some real progress. And this also comes out, and we are spilling oil all over the garage.
Put it all on the bench now. The things that I'm noticing is the races and the bearings are essentially in what appears to be perfect shape. That's really, really good news. I'm still planning on removing the races I can get to easily. I may leave the front ones. They're low wear anyway, lower stress. And getting them out of the case is just asking for trouble. So I may leave those in place. I'm going to replace all the bearings just because that's good practice. Here's why. I don't know if you can see this. I'm moving the shaft back and forth. One direction on the U-joint is perfectly fine. The other direction, a few millimeters of space there. So this was not long for this world. I don't know if there's no debris in there. So it was just starting to wear out. It may have actually worked reasonably well for a little while, but this hole would have needed to be done anyway. So this is a job that should have been done anyway. So no time wasted. Okay, use a random piece of metal. I'm pulling on the bearing carrier, which I would never do on a bearing I'm going to reuse. Hopefully it'll be enough to get it off. If it's not, it will break the bearing carrier, and then I'll be able to pull against just the lip on the inner race. So let's see how this goes. Okay, well, that didn't work out, but it did take the is that blood? It did take the bearing apart. So now I've got just a race I can work against, which is good news. Option is to drive the race off just with a hammer and a chisel, which will remove it. The points on the puller arms were just too dull to successfully grab this, and it might be easier to use the top one, but basically just keep rotating, keep tapping. It is coming off. Just takes a lot of iterations of this. Doesn't take a whole lot of force. Okay, and that's it. And the surface is in great shape. And actually, the race, if you look at it, is still essentially perfect. So these bearings were in good shape, but I still am not going to take this whole thing apart and not replace the bearings. Okay, I'm going to just remove the bearings, get them out of the way, just by using a sharp tool here to pull up the edge until I get enough wiggle room where I can start getting the actual rollers out. I just broke part of the edge. I'm going to start removing the bearings, which will... Okay, just broke the old carrier off. Now I'm going to just use the same trick. That's a sharp chisel to drive the race off, and you can see it coming already. So right, I'm going to remove the races from this case. Even though they really look just about perfect. I mean, very, very little wear. You can see where the bearings have been running. So, but there's nothing. It feels smooth as silk there, but I'm still going to replace these. I'm going to start with this one for the simple reason it is accessible from behind. I have a lip here to work against to drive it out. The lip is actually a spacer that's behind the race, but this one will give me a good idea of just how tight these are pressed in. So I'm going to use one of my drifts and just get a good edge here and just start giving it some love taps. And I can see it moving already, so the question is, not too tight. Again, take your time, go around the periphery. Don't try to do it all from one side, or you may get it hung up. Worse yet, distort the housing, which you do not want to do. Okay, it's out, and again, notice that it does have a spacer. Do not mix these up. I don't know for a fact that they're all different, but this one's going to go right back in here with under the new race. So next, we'll be tapping in the new race. Okay, to drive this in, I'm going to use the 35mm race driver, which is, you should know, a little bigger than the ones that come in most of the cheap sets you find online, so you have to go with something a little more exotic. But this should, okay, put the spacer back. This should fit just perfectly, if you can see that. That's a really snug fit. So the trick here is to get it put in square. Take your time, place the bearing well like that, and then you should just be able to hammer it down into place. And you can hear it start to ring as it nears the bottom. I'm using a smaller hammer than is typical. I got one corner up. I'm going to get a bigger hammer because bigger hammers are better. All right, I'm going to tighten my tool up and okay, it's still a little bit crooked. Looks pretty good. It will, the tone will change when you drive it all the way home. All right, it's in. So now that no damage done, it's sitting flush all the way around for the new bearing, which of course will go on here, and that'll be one of the next processes. Little trial and error, figured out this is my best tool. The way it comes out of the package, it's got a dull tip on it, so I ground it down to a little finer point, so it get a little purchase. And then it's just a matter of squeezing it under the lip of the bearing and the spacer, and working it out. And again, go around the outside working it out, and there it's out. Again, there's another spacer
inside here. Don't confuse it with anything else. But we're just going to put this one right back in so that we can't possibly get anything mixed up. Okay, now this time I'm going to use a little physics to make this easier because I'm lazy. You can see that the temperature out here, it's cool in the garage for Arizona. It's 65 degrees. I have the race sitting in the freezer. The wife doesn't know that yet. And I have a heat gun here, which I'm going to use to heat up this portion of the housing. The theory being that it will expand this part and it will shrink the race by being cool. And the two should go together like butter when I'm done. You can see already I brought it up to 105 degrees Fahrenheit. So it'll be a pretty quick process. Just have to heat soak it, and then I'll run in and grab the race. I have the driver pre-configured, ready to drive it on. Let's see how easy this one goes in. Okay, now where the race is pressed in is nearly 200 degrees. This is sitting at, well, it's hard to say. It's not, it just came out of the freezer, so it is definitely cool. So with any luck, this will go in. It's already two-thirds of the way in before I even tap it. Look at that. Okay, so now I'm just going to use, and that's all she wrote. So that's all there was to it. So it does make it easier. I do recommend heating it. I would use the same process on the ones inside the car that are harder to get to, just because it'll make them easier to drive home. If I don't change them, of course, I don't have to worry about that. But if you do, that's what you're probably going to want to do. You're going to want to freeze the race, heat the housing, which will be a little tougher in the car because it's got more material that you have to heat up. But it made it incredibly easy to drive that home. Okay, I'm going to clean up the mating surface. I'm very carefully using a razor blade to remove the majority of it. I'll use a little acetone after the fact just to clean it up a little bit more, because it's going to get resealed with basically the same thing. And so it should be a pretty clean surface to start with, just to get a good seal. All cleaned up, and now just to save time, finish up with a little compressed air just to blow any little bits of leftover sealant or anything else that ends up in there out of the housing. Okay, this is the stealthiest part of the job, where you sneak in and you put your bearings, your gears, in the freezer, and you put the bearings in the oven. In this case, I've got it preset to 200 degrees. I'm going to heat up the bearings. I've obviously cooled off the carrier, the actual helical gear assembly. And it should make driving the new bearings on trivial. I'm going to use the old races as drivers because they're precisely the right size. Put them on top and lightly tap them down with a very light hammer. I'm going to use gloves because those things are going to be hot. Okay, and we're getting there. We're at basically 200 degrees on the bearings, and so they're ready to go. Next step is put on some gloves and get the carrier out of the freezer. Have the part here. Let's see, we're sitting at, it's actually colder than that, I'm sure. It's been in the freezer for a long time. So I grab the large bearing and put it on the shaft, and I'm going to use one of the old
old bearing races to drive it. And that's all there is to it. It's down, it's sealed, perfect. This one, I'm gonna have my helper here hold it up a little bit so that we're not banging on the U-joint, not gonna stress it out. So I'm using a different race I had sitting in the garage since I didn't take the old one off. It's going down. Okay, we are down. You hear the difference in the noise? Okay, good to go. Perfect job. We now have the bearings on both sides ready for installation. Okay, out of the freezer. There we go. And ouch, ouch, ouch. Out of the oven, over the top. And why went all the way? I didn't have to use it. It just fell all the way down. So while we're in the neighborhood, let's go ahead and do the other one. Okay. Almost. Hear the difference in sound? Okay, done. This is now ready to install. All right, the case is cleaned up. The edge is all taken care of. Now we're just gonna press out the old seal, put in the new one, which should be pretty straightforward. Just leveraging against the seal in the case. Pops right out. There's already some lubricant in there. Normally I would add just a little bit. Just gonna set it in, make sure it's good and flush. I'm repurposing my race driver to put in this seal. Again, make really, really certain that it's flush. And drive it down flush with the case, just like it was. Whoops. All right, it's a little further down over there. I don't suppose that's really a problem. There's room for it to move, so I'm gonna... Yeah, that's good. All right. And everything's free and easy. That's that seal will prevent any fluid from coming out this way. And just a final clean. And now we got to put the new seal in the transfer case that's still hanging in the car, which is this one. And again, this one has to be removed and replaced before the new gear goes in, because it basically, this is where it rides. It rides more or less like this, and so we have to be very careful putting it in. I've heard it suggested to put, to actually just drive it down on this and install it from the back, pressing this into place with this gear. It's probably not a bad idea. I'm going to go ahead and press it in place. I'm going to make sure there's a little bit of grease here. It's got a beveled edge, so it really will center well, and it shouldn't have any trouble sliding on and off. So the trick is that this shaft has two thick splines, and that corresponds to two thick splines on the new drive shaft, which is still on the bench here. I'm going to lay it in place with the front unbolted so I can spin it easily and more easily line it up with this, because trying to line this up to a non-moving drive shaft is hard. Moving the drive shaft to line up to this should be easy. So let's see how that works out. Now, the getting this seal out. Getting it out is harder than getting it in. The access to pushing it in is wide open, so that's going to be easy. The hard part's getting it out. I can hit it from behind. I'm just going to use a chisel, which wouldn't be recommended if I needed to reuse this thing, that's for sure. But I'm hoping... oh yeah, it's coming out already. Okay, just a matter of tapping it out around. It should come out. Now, you don't have access to the entire circumference, so I'm going to have to take it out a little bit crooked, which I prefer not to do, but you do what you need to do. Okay. Clean up whatever residue could possibly be left on the surface, just to give yourself every possible chance of success. And then I've got to use the right hand, a very thin smear of grease around the outside. Doesn't take enough to really matter. The stuff works at a molecular level, so it's just the thinnest coating you can work should be adequate. Now the trick is place it squarely, and then the driver ever so gently. Okay, keep an eye on how it's going in, because you definitely want it to go in square. And it started just a little bit wonky, so I'm working more on this side over here. Okay. Okay. And it's just an awkward angle when I'm working between the muffler and the heat shield and the bodywork. And it's going. Okay, we're essentially flush, if you can see that. So now we have a seal that should prevent any leakage out of this thing. So now we'll want to put the, oh, by the way, before I forget it, make sure you have both of these parts on the main output shaft from the transmission. This could ride out with the gear you pull off and get lost in the shuffle. You don't want to do that. So if you don't have this, go look in the trash. You might find it there. Make sure those are both on. Again, I'm leaving the existing races in place because they are absolutely perfect. There's just no sign of any wear, tear, or abuse on any of them. So my thought is I'm more likely to cause damage pulling these out and putting the new ones in than these are going to cause. So these are just perfect. So, okay, now I'm going to place the drive shaft, which you may notice is missing, in place, which is I removed, of course, because the old one was bad. I'm not going to bolt it up so that I can rotate it to get the freedom of movement I need to connect to the output shaft. So that's the next step. All right, we're trying to get room to get the new axle in place, which is something you may or may not have to do when doing this job. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to remove this little bracket here, which is held on with two of these 8mm strange inside out nuts. And that should give us much better access to this area, because there's really no way to work around
this with the axle without removing this. So, okay, that's out of the way. And the next thing is to pull this cable out of the little clip, which gives us a whole lot more flexibility. I think we probably have the slack we need to stick the axle through here and then work it into place here. So, okay, that's the next step. Okay, now it's important that you know where your thick, your spline for the thick spline is. In this case, I've aligned the axle so that it's sitting at exactly 12 o'clock. I'm gonna keep it there so I can rotate the this assembly and get the output shaft lined up accordingly so that I'm not flailing around too bad. I'm gonna put a little dab of grease on the end of the output shaft just to help it slide through the O-ring that's in that seal that lives on the end of the drive shaft. That should make it go through a little easier. Now this is going to be odd. The trick here is this seal is very easy to damage, and if you damage it, you stop, you order, you wait, and I don't want to do that. So I'm going to try to do this in one take, where I hold the axle and the output shaft in alignment, wiggle it through that bellows that's part of the axle, or the part of the drive shaft rather, until it's sliding down. At that point, I will get it seated, and it should be sitting in there just fine because the shaft actually extends through the seal, which will help hold it in place. So wish me luck. Here we go. The problem is there's a seal in there that's just super tight. Okay. I actually went through it there. Now the trick is I just have to make sure I rotate it. Ah, there it goes. Okay, that didn't seem to stress anything out. Press it home. Okay. I think that's good. Keep in mind the drive shaft is still loose. So that's fine. I'm not going to put any more tension on it. I'm going to put the other helical gear in place, and then I can place the back of the of course I should have cleaned this up first. This side is actually pretty good, but I am going to trim this little first things first. I would recommend doing it not the way I did it, so clean this up first. Just to get the debris off. It's not bad, so I can work around this, but I'm going to leave this in place just because I don't want to go through that again. Okay, I'm going to try to slide the other gear in place, and they will be pushed into perfect alignment by the whenever I put the back case on. So it's going to be just like a little press. So that's pretty good. They're in there. And now we are ready to put the middle case on. So got to go prep it and add the special RTV and hope for the best. Okay, now we add a thin, doesn't have to be very thick, layer of RTV around the case, centered around the screws, making sure that whenever the two halves come together, that this will more than make up for any tiny mechanical imperfections or misalignments, so that it's sealed and that you don't end up with transmission fluid all over your garage floor. Touch up any spots that look a little low. Be sure you have enough. A little too much won't be a big deal. It'll
squeeze in, it'll leave a bead on the inside of the case or the outside of the case, which is perfectly fine and natural. And you saw we actually peeled that off from the existing factory installed RTV, so it's good practice. So we look like we got a good seal all the way around. It bears double checking, because if you miss a spot, you could have a leak. Okay, so I think that's going to do it. And just as a curiosity, notice that there's a fill port on the side of this. It sits like this in the car. So you could actually fill up your transmission from above the front output shaft bump, although there's no way in the world you'd ever reach that. So I'm assuming this is a factory thing. They probably fill at the factory like this, or possibly at a shop when they're putting in a new transmission. Okay, here's the moment of truth. Trying to slide this carefully into place. And you notice I left this corner down to grab the back of the output shaft gear. Okay, now the trick is to rotate this so that the locating pins drop in. Okay, I got the top one. And having trouble getting the bottom one in. I believe that's because the shaft is a little low. Maybe I can push it into place from the outside there. Once it's in place, I'm sure it's going to okay. That felt pretty good. Okay, it's now sitting in place. I'm going to use, may not need it, but use a dead blue hammer just to help seat it. Okay, that felt pretty good. Now it's just a matter of getting all the bolts started. In this case, we're going to do the hard ones last, so I just need to find the bolts. And remember, the two long ones go in here, so I'll start out with them. Gonna go around, go easy, just snug to start out with. Have to work around the muffler, the exhaust, which is interesting. I'm gonna get the ones I can get easy. Okay, and get the top ones because I can actually get the tool on them easier. The point being, I want to get this thing flat down against the RTV to give it every possible opportunity to seal square and flat. Again, remember, I'm using a wobble here, which gives me the opportunity going from slightly wrong angle anyway. Okay, that's enough of them for now. Now I'm going to start driving them home with a ratchet and a torque wrench. because I've got just about all the ones I can tighten with the with my little impact already done. Okay, snugging these down a little bit. Again, not going for full torque yet, but you can see the RTV squishing properly out of the seam, which tells you that there's enough and that it's filled the void and that there is just a little bit too much, which is exactly what you want. So I'm going around tightening all of these I can get. The ones that were hard to take out are hard to put in, but they're all reachable. I could probably relocate that shift linkage. Might make it a little bit easier, but I suspect it'd be more trouble to take it out than it would be. It would save me time, so I'm just gonna work around it. And the last one is the hard one, of course. There's just not quite enough room to swing my torque wrench up in the space. So I'm going to use a U-joint and bring it down here and basically turn it from back behind this exhaust pipe to get that last one tightened. And then I'm done with the middle case and can start putting the gear back together and then the back case. Okay, where are you? There it is. Okay, time to put the final drive in here. Let's see. And this should be an interesting process. Okay, there's lots of little gears inside this thing, and I'm thinking they don't like to line up. Okay, not going on. Here, let me rotate it around a little bit. That's better. Needs to go further down. I'm going to try removing this, putting it on a clean rag, and then see if I can kind of guide all these internal gears here into the right alignment to slide down on that helical shaft. Okay, really didn't do anything different, just wiggled it one more time and it went in. Now, maybe equally difficult to get this lined up to slide over all those gears, I don't know. I know on the bench it was just a little fiddly to get the whole thing together. I may have some luck. There we go. Okay, slide that out just a little bit. I think that is in place. Okay, the all right. Okay.
pushing it down. Okay, that needs to go in. Okay, that goes in. The other device has to sit on top of this. Well, I suppose that's in there. The other thing is the bolt that holds this all together is the long torque to yield bolt, which undoubtedly will seat this thing fully whenever it's installed. So, okay, now everything's about as seated as I think it's going to be. And you pull out your $50 bolt. This is the brand new one, so that it is a torque to yield bolt. Do not reuse. You see it's got thread locker on it of some sort. It goes in, it gets torqued to 22 foot-pounds and then turned an additional 180 degrees. That's half a turn for those of you not into geometry. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start off by I'm just going to start off by tightening it to snug with a regular ratchet, and then I'm going to use a beam style because I don't want to take any chances at all of ruining this this bolt. Again, it's like 50 bucks. Took me at least a week to get it. Okay, and it holds this whole assembly in place. So, okay, it's snugging up now. I'm not going to take it any further than that. Now I go to the beam style torque wrench because I just like the I like the feedback I get on it better. So I'm pushing it. Did not get to 20. Alright. Okay, there was... I'm going to give it one more little turn. There's 20 foot-pounds. 20, let's see. That's perfect. Okay, now I've got to turn it half a turn. Now, I obviously don't have room to swing a... don't have room to swing that, so I'm going to go get a smaller ratchet and use that. Okay, kill it. Okay, if you can see this, no you can't. Okay, this wrench is, it's got a head that's got a horizontal surface on it, so I'll be able to tell when I've turned it 120 degrees. Or 180. And that's it, folks. That's in there. That is good and tight. Now we just got to put the back of the back of this device on. Locked up. Okay, this goes on. Should sit down flush underneath the there. Alrighty, and next the C-ring goes in. Just work it around, pinch the side up, slide it home, and it's now back just like it was when I took it apart, except new bearings. Okay, now it's time to prep the back cover and install that. Okay, prep the cover. It's cleaned. It's got a thin line of transmission RTV around it. Just carefully rotate it into place. Slide it carefully over the shaft. And then as when it came off, just a matter of wiggling it home, very gently back and forth movements, more so as you get closer, because once we start seating it, the RTV will come into contact. And I'm gonna try my dead blow hammer trick. And I think it's starting to go on. It's just really fiddly. I suppose I could probably get bolts started at this point, and that might be just the ticket. Because once I get them started, they'll just help pull this whole thing down into place. And while that's not the total solution, I think it's going to be enough to get us where we need to be. And it also keeps it from rotating, which is a good thing. So, oh yeah, there we go. Okay, so that seems to be the trick, is to get a couple bolts in to hold the alignment. There's a couple locating pins that perhaps weren't quite dead center. So at this point, I'm just going to insert all the bolts, snug them down, and then bring them to torque, which is, if I recall correctly, around, like 10 foot-pounds, give or take. Not a whole lot. So again, don't go gorilla on these, or you'll be doing things over again in short order. Okay. Using my small torque wrench, set to about 7 foot-pounds, which is just a very low amount. And so you really have to listen for the tool to click. I'm going to start at the bottom and work my way up. And you can see again, we got a good amount of squeeze out between the two cases to indicate that the sealing was complete with the RTV. So they're all torqued down. Next step is to replace the yoke on the back. I'm going to add just a little bit of grease to these output splines, because it's basically, I just don't want it to ever get seized, and this is just good maintenance. Must not have it square. Oh, there we go. Okay, that's on. Now, again, I'm going to add just a little bit of grease around this. This reminds me too much of an axle bolt, and I've had too many bad fights with axle bolts in the past because they got rusty. And this is Arizona, so I don't expect that's going to happen. But let's go ahead and give ourselves every opportunity for success here. Okay. Okay, the easy part is going to be getting this started. The hard part is going to be getting it torqued to spec, which is like 200 newton meters, I think 147 foot-pounds. That translates into a lot. So I'm going to start with my small impact, which does not come close to over-torquing it. I think this tool is rated at something like 80 foot-pounds. All right, there's that. Okay. All right, so move things around here a little bit. All right, let's see if I can rotate it a little happier spot. All right. What is it twisting?
It's twisting. Go ahead. Oops.
Done.
Good.
I'm gonna call that good. That's tight.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I think that's plenty. You want to give it another pull? I'll hold it in place. You just give it a good, solid, sharp pull. Okay. Listen, I heard a click. Okay. That's good. All right. Next, the only thing left is to use a drift to put a dimple back in the spot to keep the bolt from ever loosening up, which I don't think, honestly, is ever going to be a problem. But because it's there, we're going to do it. Okay. Okay, I can probably, if I rotated it so that it was actually pointing straight down, it would probably be easier, but I'm just gonna... Okay, that's enough of a dimple. All I care about is that it is enough to capture that to keep it from ever coming loose, which... that will do. So I'm going to call that good and move on. Okay, that's a little more of a dimple. And truth be told, I'm only going to do one side because it's just too much of a pain in the butt to undo if I ever have to take this thing off again. So I'm sure that's going to hold it in place so we can start reassembling the rest of the car. Start getting them back down. All right. There's one. And of course, make sure and line up the alignment marks you made when you took it apart so that the U-joints will be in sync. Otherwise, you're going to have vibrations and weirdness and things you're not going to really want to deal with. So, do that. All right. We have now tightened the front and the back of the rear prop shaft, aka drive shaft. Now it's time to connect the center support bearing, and it has to be done after these two are done. The center support bearing was actually essentially exactly where it needed to be. Didn't have to touch a thing. It just jumped into place, so it must be happy. Let's get the other bolt started, and these again are fairly low torque bolts. So don't go gorilla on them, and I think they're like 10 foot-pounds or so. Plenty. All right. There it is. nice and snug. The center support bearing is still good and solid. The U-joints are awesome. I'm a happy boy. Okay, now we can start putting all of these covers back together. All right, I didn't bore you with the details, but the splash panels are back in place. The brace, the frame braces, transmission mount, cross brace, everything's back in place. If you took it off, you know how it goes on. Everything is buttoned up with the exception of the fluid level in the transmission, which I'll be doing next. Now, that is an unusual transmission if you haven't dealt with one of these, in that it's actually filled through the drain plug, because there's a standpipe in here that ends at the proper height for the depth of the transmission fluid with the transmission at a particular temperature, which is 113 degrees Fahrenheit, 45 degrees Celsius. So the trick is we're going to have to run the car up, get it warm enough to that point, pump fluid into it, and we only lost, I'm thinking, probably two-thirds, three-quarters of a quart max, which is fairly amazing. Definitely better to have drained it through the transfer case than the transmission. Saved a lot of fluids. Okay, got the scanner plugged in, waiting for the temperature to get up to the 45 degree C range. Coming up soon. And based on what we got out of the transmission, I'm going to use my sight line here to pump in something under a liter of fluid to make sure I have enough. I'm going to use my new fancy adapter here that takes the place of the drain plug. A standard fluid pump that will just pump the fluid straight up through here into the transmission. When it's up to temperature, then all I have to do is pull this off, wait for it to stop dribbling out, put the drain plug in, and I'm done. I should mention that I have indeed shifted through the gears. That's one of the prerequisites for this process, and I'll do it again just to be safe. Hope I'm not getting my gear shift too dirty. So do that several times. That just puts all the fluid everywhere it can possibly go so that the level you're getting is accurate and meaningful. So we're up to 38 degrees, and it does take a while. Okay, drain plug comes out with a 6mm Allen. I've got the output hose hooked up to my little adapter, which is screwed in place of the drain plug. Now I'll just take it over and insert the inlet end into the jug of tranny fluid, and I'll get ready to start pumping when the temperature hits 45, which it's actually there. So it's actually a little bit over, so it's time to get pumping. Okay, I've pumped about a liter of fluid into the transmission. I'm going to double check my temperature. Okay, it's 55. That's more than hot enough. So I'm going to pull the hose off, and I expect I will get a little bit. Okay, yeah, I am getting a little flow. Tells me my fluid is probably just about right. Okay, so now next step is to take the finger out of the way of the lens, take the little adapter off, and put the drain plug back in. So it's just a tiny little spritz coming out now. And Okay. That pipe is hot. Okay. Nice and snug, not crazy tight. And the looks like the there we go. So we're out. Now clean up the carnage. And I believe I've got an operational car again. Hooray.